Hi, folks. I do want to get started because our panelists, our guests today have such great things to work through. They've got a lot that they're going to be sharing, which I think will be relevant, poignant, and hopefully helpful for you all. Before we begin, however, I have some remarks. As we begin, please allow me to recognize that concurrent with the pandemic environment, many of our efforts and attention are also trained on battling white supremacy, identifying and addressing our internal struggle with both racism and bias, and fighting for justice in our communities. For many of us, this is not a new fight. And this may be triggering to some in the audience, but certainly we are faced with grieving new wounds and trauma given the events of recent days. Pretending that today is business as usual, and for me that would be just another webinar, would be inauthentic and silencing. Folks at DScout are facing a major wake-up call ourselves. I am that much more grateful that you are willing to contribute your time, labor, and insights today to be with us. And with that, I welcome you to our People Nerds webinar for June, Working Together While We Are Apart, featuring, I'll call them colleagues and dare I say friends, as usual, Mike Buzzard and Margaret Lee, both from Google's UX community and culture team. So with that, let's get to our speakers. I'm the moderator, Ben. I'm the evangelist at DScout, and I am so very pleased to introduce two of the founding members of the UX community and culture team at Google, Margaret Lee, the UX director, and Mike Buzzard, design manager. Welcome to you both.
Thank you.
Thanks. So great to have you both. The format will be largely discussive. Mike, Margaret, and I have prepared we were just joking, pages of notes. So we have a few broad themes around which we'll be anchoring our conversation. And I'm hoping that we could start with the notion of UX at a place as large both in headcount and large in scale of work like Google. I'm hoping we could talk about defining what UX means to a place like Google, because it informs how the team was itself created and some of its goals.
Sure, I can start with that. UX today is pretty much full stack. We're comprised of a lot of different flavors of design, you know, visual, interaction, industrial, motion, et cetera. Research, quant, qual, UX engineering, content strategy, UX writing, and program management. And that's a pretty big evolution from, I'd say, 10, 15 years ago when it was largely design and research. And even then it was, you know, even narrower in each of those spectrums. So we've grown quite a bit.
Yeah, I would say when I joined about 8 years ago, it was a little bit confusing, the terminology, because having come from my own agency, UX was more synonymous at that time with like interaction design specifically as a discipline. And so when I got into Google, I quickly realized that it was this overarching umbrella of all of these different roles, and even in some cases, you know, engineers who are thinking about latency as affecting the experience would consider themselves sort of a user experience contributor. So it can be a muddy definition. And then over that time, I've also watched like a lot of discipline-focused groups self-organize into very formally operating structures. And so it's kind of been like maybe watching the boroughs of New York evolve and develop around you, where they have their own self-governing models.
Yeah, and I think that is, I like to start with that because I think that speaks to the reasons or some of the primary functions and motivations for creating a team like community and culture. So I'm hoping we could first start with maybe talking a bit about what cultivating community means for such a diverse group like that. It's both a very broad charter, an important one, but you know, you're working with a set of folks with different workflows, different interfacing. What does that mean, cultivating community, for the two of you and your team vis-a-vis that wider UX group?
Yeah, and I think choosing the word cultivating is really key, because that's what we're doing. We're not creating anything, because frankly, community is going to exist with or without intervention, you know, from teams like ours. But the opportunity is to try to cultivate it so that it's a healthy culture. You know, we cultivate the conditions so that the community can thrive. Because otherwise, you know, like I said, community will exist with or without us, but with a little bit of investment, it can really thrive. So that's how I kind of see it.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of just being very comfortable with knowing that you know very little in this space, and being comfortable and responsible with experimenting. So, you know, really listening to the audience that grows and evolves really quickly, like the different, like the sub communities I was talking about, just as they self-organize and they recognize shared needs, and we need to be open to hearing and attentive to trying to figure out ways to address those needs and what might be replicated elsewhere. So I think we just have to be comfortable with knowing that we don't know a lot.
Yeah,
I think, and I think that that's so useful for putting the UX as the prefix to this community and culture, you know, user-centered thinkers, not just researchers, but designers and engineers and folks who work on teams that interface with UX folks are, to Mike's point, naturally curious. They believe advocating for the unknown makes things better. Like, well, we don't exactly know why folks click here or want that. And so I think similarly, taking that ethos to something that is ambiguous, but important as something like culture and community is, again, speaks to that nature at Google of being having inquisitions about or inquiring about various things like that. So could we talk about? Oh, go ahead, Margaret. I'm sorry. Please.
Yeah, I was going to say also. I think as we scaled, we really could see how much more challenging it was to actually create that. As we scaled globally, we decentralized into many different sub teams and whatnot. And as the function itself evolved to become, you know, more full stack across all the sub-disciplines, it becomes really challenging to focus on the community part as something that can be intentionally tended to if you don't have somebody investing in it, right? So what tends to happen is like the sub-communities might do pretty well, but as an overall community, it becomes harder to connect across those org lines. So, you know, having that investment in the people part separate from like the product development process, I think was the piece that we were really interested in going after.
And Mike, you had said something about being, again, coming to Google a bit later than Margaret and seeing on the front lines some of the work that designers were doing. The phrase that you had was outward and upward. I thought that was quite striking. You were recognizing again in one of the subcommittees that did I do it where, and I caught you on a phrase that you might not have remembered.
No, I don't recall that.
That's it. You had discussed how being working again with the frontline designers, thinking about both development and evolution as a designer for oneself, and then again relative to these other sub communities, maybe wanting to move to ones or support others, surfaced in your mind that we might need, we meaning Google community more broadly, might need to really be thinking about and maybe codify what we mean by like culture or togetherness or how this sort of set of activities informs this set of activities. I'm hoping you could talk a bit about how you started to surface, sort of put your hand up and say, hey, I think we should have a team like this. Because it didn't, wasn't always around.
I appreciate you packaging it as if there was like a strategic intention to it all.
Yes, take it, Mike.
I like to describe it as sort of naive instigation was what I was doing. So I'd worked with Google for 7 years before joining, and I was familiar with the culture from the outside. And once I joined, started to recognize how things worked and where there were what I perceived as needs, just based on information I was picking up and carrying around from the relationships I had prior to joining. And so then I was just poking at things, you know, like if we're talking about designers and this is the space we talk about them, how do we broaden that space or how do we focus on this part over here? So once I could change that conversation, then it was, well, then how do we change like the lens in which we're seeking out those individuals so that it goes to recruiting and what is the documentation we use for evaluation? So it just kind of, again, that sort of naive instigation and bumbling through stuff revealed one need after the other.
And Margaret, how did you get involved with the community and culture work either before the team self-codified or after?
So I'd been at the point that the community and culture team formed, which is about 4 years by now. I had been at Google for about 9+ years leading the Google Maps UX team. And just through that process of building the team from like a couple people to this global UX org, you get to see a lot of the pain points and the opportunities, just in terms of, like I said, the non-product part of the job, right? Which is like the staffing and the development of the team. And, you know, even, and this is where Mike did a lot of work too, in the evolution of the UX discipline itself, because, you know, over the course of 10 years, a lot happens in tech, right? And, you know, it's not just engineering needing to catch up with the technology and whatnot and exploiting the possibilities of technology, but also like the user experience expectations grew quite a bit. And I know Mike was doing a lot of work in terms of like diversifying our notion of what design was, which early on was really equated with interaction design largely. And so all that type of thing is culture. You know, it is the culture of, you know, what does UX look like? What is it, what, you know, what do we comprise, you know, UX of, and what's our influence? You can only have good influence if you have the right people coming in, right? Contributing and making impact. So it was a lot of these issues that I could see over the course of building and, you know, leading this UX team for one of the big products at Google, that, and I could see this with my colleagues who are leading other product UX teams across the company. We shared all the same pain points. It wasn't like it was unique to a product. It was specific to, you know, UX as a discipline evolving and maturing at the company. So when I was ready to move on, I was like, what do I want to do next? You know, what, how have I been spending my 20% time? Maybe that's a hint for like what I'm kind of passionate about. And so I wrote this one pager just proposing the germ of what UXCC is now. But, you know, we've since expanded way beyond that initial one pager in terms of scope and whatnot. And proposed it, and Mike and I shared a manager at that point, and he sort of put us together as like, yeah, you two kind of have some complementary ambitions, right, and tendencies. So, and then we brought in a third teammate, Kristen, who had been focusing on how to get design excellence as a shared vernacular across Google, you know, by figuring out like, how do you define it? What's the shared vocabulary and how we value, you know, what comprises excellence and whatnot. So the three of us came together and we became UXCC, and we defined the program and set sail, but I almost said set it on fire, but you could take your pick.
Certainly. Yes, certainly. And I want the audience to know that during our practice session last week, the Mike and Margaret said that in the time since UXCC has formed, the UX community has doubled in terms of the, like, again, the diversity in opinions and perspectives and workflows and leveling and one-on-ones, the sort of nexus of things that they are thinking about has doubled in that time. And Mike, you had mentioned the importance of legitimacy, and there's a leadership council that's associated with UXCC. Could you talk about the importance of getting leadership, their buy-in and their involvement at the start of something like UXCC?
Yeah. I want to back up a little bit too, because Margaret tells a really, we have different perspectives on how that came to be, but very similar at the same time. Margaret was always a sounding board for me as I was doing a lot of this sort of instigating around the company. I'd come back to her and I'd be charged with like, this thing is not working, or we can make this better. And she would sort of calm me and guide me. And because she'd been putting a lot of structure in place up until that point, and she could fill me in and give me the bigger picture, stuff like that. So we had been working together in this community focused sort of cultural influence capacity. It was just very casual and informal. So yeah, when I think Bobby, when you recognize you're doing similar things, you're complementary and sort of what you were using the opportunity, that's how he came to ask Margaret to put the proposal together to build the team. What was the other question again? Sorry, I wanted to give
my actually the formation of UXLC, if you want, I can talk
about that. So this helps with that.
How you made that goal legitimate.
So Margaret became this, like, in the same way of legitimizing the work that I would do. I would go to some of like the more senior directors around the company. Martin was a key one of those to figure out like, am I working on the right thing? Is this the right problem to solve? That sort of thing. And so when we created the team, Margaret then formed, there were already these over time, like natural circles of conversation amongst UX leadership to make decisions, but it wasn't a formal body. And so they created what is like a board of directors, like a very well-defined operating agreement and how it functions and things like that, what the rules and responsibilities are to to look holistically across UX beyond their business unit, UX team needs or cross-functional needs, but across the whole company, and what is the community and the culture need now and tomorrow. And it's also important to recognize that there isn't a single head of UX or design at Google. So it was necessary that we have one source to go to for validating or sort of confirming some of the opportunities that we thought should be prioritized.
And how large, please.
I was gonna say, well, there's nine people on this, it's called UX Leadership Council. And I was on it for the first tenure, which was like 3 years, and it's since rotated as we're, you know, we had agreed upon operating roles and whatnot. So it was a very interesting commitment, because it was like, it was very serious and formal, and it wasn't just a 20% thing, as 20% things can sometimes feel like, which, you know, it's your free will to participate, right? This feels above and beyond that to me, because the leaders that sit on it take this so seriously and are really, really committed to, you know, creating the right kind of change and to address the most important problems that span Google that UX can have an impact on. And so it's actually gone above and beyond what, you know, we had imagined it would be, which we just thought, you know, initially we were just like, we'd be really grateful for a guiding board that can, you know, do what Mike said, like help provide that leadership guidance across the company, but also, you know, the air cover and all that. But this group has been so invested that, you know, there's work streams that come out of it, and we've been able to, you know, provide that operational arm, the UX community culture team, to support that. And so it's almost like it's doubled our workload in some ways, you know, and our team has expanded because of it. But just like I said, it's gone so much above and beyond that initial one pager in terms of what we thought we would, you know, possibly do with this. So yeah. It really kind of spoke to, like, there was such a need that, like, once we sort of opened up the, you know, involvement, right, the engagement with the right folks, it just like mushroomed.
Yeah.
So I saw part of an interesting question that came up. What were the objectives or priorities of, I didn't fully read it though. Was it of the council or was it of our team at the time?
I guess if we could move to either the how you are carrying out that charter of developing, cultivating, and expanding the community and culture of UX, we might ask or answer Alex's question. It's a great one, Alex. Thank you for asking it. So if we could move to sort of some of the day in and day out.
How did it start? Again, when I was doing the work that I was doing, I was, for the first time in my life, removed from making and deliverable. So I had to put a framework and a structure to how I talk about my work. And so it started with talent was a near-term thing that I did, which could be followed by community, where needing to engage talent. I talked about culture as being in the, like, the hiring committee and sort of the hiring program process stuff. And then had this idea that, you know, Google's an engineering company and engineers read docs. So if we rewrite the docs, we could change the culture. So it kind of drove in that regard. And then a lot of partnerships at that time, like as we were building the team, we were working with the agencies, right? A lot of networks. So I needed this framework. And then as we formed the team, a lot of, you know, we took an audit of everything we were already doing to try to figure out, like, how does this fit in the bigger picture? That's my perspective of how kind of we got it up and going. But I don't know, Margaret, what's your?
Yeah, I think some of those, you know, what you refer to as talent. So some of that is like, how do we attract the right folks, and what's our hiring process for getting people in? And, you know, once they're in, what's the plan for developing them so that they have a fruitful career at Google and whatnot. So there was a lot of early, I guess you could call them sort of low hanging fruit. They weren't really low hanging fruit. They were just the more obvious things that we could, you know, lean into and work with. Cause, you know, there was just such an obvious need. Right. But, so yes, I think the talent stuff, and then, like you said, it just naturally went into community, because we need so many volunteers to help us do things like help with recruiting, help with interviewing, help with hiring committees, et cetera, so that we needed to have a better relationship with the community and to cultivate that sense amongst the community so that they understood sort of like the importance of it, because basically what we're trying to do is cultivate the community that we would want through people, right? So I think that was a natural thing. And then the other, I think, obvious area that we early weighed into was just like helping with knowledge sharing across all the different organizations or silos, as I often can see them, because sometimes it's like there's so much wealth of information within the product areas, but it's harder to get that cross-pollination across. So that was another area where we invested heavily in building frameworks. And we are not in the business of creating all the best practices, because the best practices exist out there amongst the community. It was more, how do we enable the community to best share and connect their best practices with one another?
Those were part of our early pillars were community, talent, and knowledge, and culture was the derivative of all of that work, or how we could influence that work. But then we also early on had engagement models or ways we thought about engaging teams, whether we were supporting something or kind of helping to scale something that already existed, or investing in something that was trying to get off the ground, or whether it was something that we were fully owning and driving that took a heavier lift from us. So early on, I think it was important to recognize like we couldn't do all of the things that were needed, and how do we think about the work that we feel is important and how we can or should invest in it in different ways to help it find success. So a lot of learning and a lot of experimentation.
Yeah, I was struck by how you had these twin foci. That's right, foci. I seem to get it in every webinar. You both wanted to empower and cultivate culture through programming, whether those are events, meet and greets, lunch and learns. And then y'all talked a lot about doing so in a non-governing way to sort of tap into some of the self-organizing groups that were already happening naturally, absent maybe even these folks knowing about the UXCC. Could you talk a bit about how you're both developing programming at a UX macro level for lots of different folks, like I'm thinking UXU, for example, and then how you're also working with these self-organizing groups to, again, tap their localized expertise to then say, oh, well, this group is saying they really would benefit from this, and so how can we go about helping empower them to do that?
I think one thing that we recognized early on, the ratio of whatever size our team is relative to the community that we're serving is always like, you know, really extreme, right? So it's really important for us to recognize how we can have impact, because we can't have impact in trying to govern other people's purviews, right? Whatever they may be, like on the product side. So that's why we deliberately, you know, really stay away from specific product things. And where we can help is connecting all these sub-communities who naturally form, because again, community is going to exist with or without us. And our job is just to nudge it into the healthy, you know, direction. And the way to do that actually is to connect the people that need to be connected in order to like have that amplifying effect. I don't know if that sounds too vague, but honestly, that's often how I see it, is like our job is to like be the connectors, you know? Because at a company the size of Google, it's really hard to see all the possible connections and networks, like when your day job is also to go deep into a product. But since we're not going deep into a product, we can spend our time and investment like really kind of identifying the connections specifically so that people can come together. So these self-organized subcommittees of like the UXRs have a steering committee, same with like UX engineers, the writers have one, et cetera, the program managers. And then they can go deep into the needs of their functions and their sub-communities and surface it. And we can make the connections across them. Like what are the themes that we're hearing that are UX and not specific to a sub-community, and assist with that. And often there's a lot of overlap and there's a lot of complementary opportunities to support one another.
Even 4 years in, it's still a learning exercise, right? Like in the beginning, we were like, oh, this group is self-organized and seemingly high functioning and motivated. And how do we get involved, listen to them, give our input, thoughts, and ideas? And then we learn back from them. And then as another group starts to emerge, you know, a year or two later, maybe it's the visual designers, we have a little bit of a foundation of knowledge there already, but they might have very different, unique ideas. So it's kind of like always being open to, well, here's where we think you are and how you could get to where you want to go. But we also, like, keep us close so we can also learn from it as well.
Yeah. And, you know, we've been talking about subcommunities in the context of function, but there's also regional ones, right? Geographic ones.
Right.
Like, so there's different dimensions to it.
Yeah. I think it's instructive to me hearing how the team works, how non-prescriptive your team wanted to be, again, about a thing that, to try to operationalize what culture means. I mean, you may have, Google certainly has values on which they are, I'm sure, trying to mirror the work of the group, but to go into a subcommittee and say, here's how culture should be developed, do these three things, that won't be practical, useful, and you'll likely get pushback. So it's struck me how much of this is, again, to Mike's point, frameworks, talking about outcomes, and then trying to give folks templates and ways that they can begin to self-organize or empowering those who are.
Yeah.
I'm hoping we could move now to, Margaret, what you just referenced, which is before a global pandemic forces 99% of the workforce to be remote, Google itself was already a very distributed team. Yeah. And so as you, Mike, and your teammates were forming UXCC, you were thinking about a team that was centrally located in, or located in some physical co-presence, but you did have your eye on distributed teams working and contributing. How has the present moment of vastly more distributed work shifted or evolved your team's thinking? What are some of the things that you're working on?
Well, yeah, I mean, we clearly had to do a lot of quick pivots because much of, you know, one of our biggest events that we're known for, called UXU or UX University, is an in-person event, right? Mm-hmm. And it takes place over the course of a week, and, you know, a couple thousand people come to it every year. I mean, it's huge, you know. Clearly we weren't going to do that. And we had many smaller variations of that type of event as well, all around the world. And we really had to think about, like, number one, what does the community need now? So separate from anything that we might have done. So that was really important. And to think about what were the things that these other events provided, you know, what value did it provide that we might be able to still provide in a virtual asynchronous context. And so we started thinking about that. It was really important for us to not think about how do we just second class citizen, you know, an in-person event as a virtual one. We didn't want to just kind of like brick for brick type approach, but really look at it anew, like what is the need now? Because clearly this was, you know, sure, it can be about opportunity now, but like in the beginning, like back in March, it really felt like a need. There was a sense of urgency around what could we provide now. And what we found was what usually happens with the community anyway, is that a lot of people self-organize, a lot of people have ideas, they want to put them out there. Mm-hmm. And the same was happening during this time. Everybody started generously offering suggested resources, you know, like, you know, anything from like, if you're looking for a chair that's beyond your dining room chair to sit in 8 hours a day,
sure.
You know, here's the research I've done, to like, hey parents, I know you're juggling a lot, here's some resources I found or whatever. So just like a whole host. And, you know, what we were able to do was basically to like curate them and to create a more easily accessible repository, you know, on like our intranet. And so we were just trying to see what can we do in a really timely manner that might be different than what we used to do, which was these like very polished events, right? Like it's not about the polish right now. It's about like helping people. But Mike, I don't know if you have thoughts to add on to that.
Yeah, I mean, chaos was the beginning of it. You know, we have some general guiding principles of connecting people to share knowledge and inspire. And the result of that is, advancing the people, the process, the product within Google. And so like those things are still true, even though they're a little more large and abstract, they're a little bit, they provide guidance. And so we actually had this training by PJ on our team is talking about this concept of chaos. And there was a scene from the movie, was it Apollo 13? can't remember which one, with Tom
Hanks.
Mm-hmm. Where like all of a sudden they're figuring out there's a scenario they hadn't planned for, and they just dump all the stuff on the table and they're like, okay, this is what we have to construct from this stuff. It kind of felt a little like that. Like we had things that were working in the past. We knew the purpose of those things and how they delivered value. And to Margaret's point, you can't just move them onto meat or something and expect everything to be normal. So I think we are in a place, having listened and asked questions and gained some insight both on what's going on externally and a lot of our internal community. And again, back to being just kind of observant and looking for needs, figured out what we think are some good approaches. And we've started out with some small experiments. We're building on that. And it's getting to what I think is the fun part now, which is enhancing all that stuff. So like, let's run it, let's see what we did wrong or different, and how do we fine tune that, and then how do we share that back. So it was chaos for a while, but like, I think having both, I guess, intrinsic and extrinsic purpose for the work that we were doing helped guide us through like problem solving aspects there.
Yeah. And, you know, I mean, we've recently had chaos on top of chaos. So it being adaptable is something that is so important right now. And however we can also pass that capability on to the community, I think is also like the way that we can be helpful. One of our teammates, Kai, she runs this Sprint Master Academy within Google. And a lot of it was reliant on in-person engagement. And she and her team quickly pivoted to create like a remote design kit that people could automatically, not like very quickly, leverage. And she's been iterating on that since. And it's that type of like, you know, that's what we just need to do, is just be really quick. I think before pre-pandemic, right, we might have focused a little bit more on polish on some of these events. And now it's like, yeah, I think it's okay. We can change how we do things, you know, because this is a different context, a completely different context.
Yeah.
But there is also, now that we've been doing this for a few months, we're also seeing that a lot of what we do probably will have lasting value. It's not like we're just doing this band-aid thing that will serve us for whatever length of time. Like remote collaboration will always be important. Asynchronous communication around the globe, always important. So, you know, I don't feel like this is I think this is just part of the evolution of what we have to do. Yeah.
And each of you spoke about experimentation several times, trying different things, not knowing exactly what will work. Yeah. I'm also struck by the breadth of things that you've had to think about. Margaret, you mentioned in our practice session that it's been the micro level, like, well, how do we help folks whiteboard if they can't be at a whiteboard? Do we ship them whiteboards? Do we empower them with whiteboard software? All the way up to, as you referenced, like, well, now we have a bunch of folks who are either parents or guardians or stewards of other lives that are disrupted. How do we also focus on that community? And so y'all have been juggling, you know, both ends of those, empower and uplift folks to do and help forward Google's mission. And so your team has had to, again, sort of like turn the box over and go like, okay, are we shipping people whiteboards and pens? And how do we make the parents not so crazy? And you're doing that in a week. That's what you're doing this week, is trying to empower these large groups. And I think it's important for our audience to know that you are, you work with HR, you're working with the people teams, you all are interfacing with lots of other teams who then might not be charged with, but sort of take the baton and work on some of these other things. It's not all being generated. I mean, you're the nexus of some of the ideas and you're certainly the feedback collectors, but you also work a lot with the people team and HR and staffing and the like to help, again, Google respond.
Yeah, I mean, it's the same concept of, you know, being the connector, as I was talking about, like even with all the volunteer steering committees and whatnot within UX, it's the people whose actual day jobs it is to focus on, you know, hiring or whatnot for across the company. And I, you know, again, sometimes I just see our role as being the antidote to the tyranny of structural silos, right? Which is just, honestly, I don't even think it's just a big company problem, because I think small companies often have this, you know, it's just easy to have the mentality of like, here's my backyard, this is my purview, that's your backyard, that's your purview. And people just often don't, you know, look over the fence often enough, right? Yeah. So I think that that's our job, is just to kind of like, you know, be the drone over the community and figure out like where the gaps are and how to bring it together. I don't claim that we're the experts in remote collaboration, parenting, blah, 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 all that, because all that expertise is out there. We just have to kind of bring them together so that, you know, the effect is greater.
Can we change that to be our mission statement, to be the antidote to tyrannical organizational silence?
Tyranny of structural silence.
Sure. Drone, and you're being, we are the Google parent drone. I like that. Perfect. We're having some questions from folks about specific tools or approaches that you're using to interface more broadly with the community. I'm guessing that there's a lot of G Suite use, but have you found something that's been working in this time of extra distributed workforce, a way that folks are more likely to respond? Is there something synchronous or asynchronous you're using that you've been liking?
If anything, I feel like it's gone, and for me, in many ways, more analog, less everything being centered around like purpose and project. Mm-hmm. So that always is going on. Like, we can independent spaces, we can find heads down time like never before in many ways. I think the things that were most noticeable to me, and I'm still reconciling, is like as being a connector. A lot of that is not over structured conversation. A lot of it is, but a lot of it isn't. And growing your network and sort of picking up information and putting it down. So the hallway moments, the water cooler, the micro kitchen, all of that to me is like the valuable intangibles or less like defined and structured tangibles. So I'm trying to keep that in mind to the point, I keep showing this and it feels like a prop now, but like I have, you know, a printout of our team that sits in front of me so I can try to keep them in sight and in mind. And like, if I haven't talked to somebody in a while, I think so it's less the tools designed for productivity and connectivity, which naturally you just adapt for the moment or the environment, but more of the, how do we create those other moments that so much like valuable information exchange occurs in.
I'm wondering.
Margaret has the secret weapon tool though.
Yes. Margaret, why don't you go ahead and just put a pin in an answer? Well, here's what we use.
Well, so in terms of like, an actual tool or, you know, best practice, I think the community's experimenting with a lot of different tools right now. And I know that because we have a very active email list, you know, amongst all the UXers around the globe. And again, there are also like sub lists, right, for different interests within UX. So there's a lot of sharing there going on right now actively. And in somewhat typical Google fashion, there isn't like one tool that the entire company uses.
Yeah.
And I think that that's fine. I mean, at the scale that we're at, it seems like there usually are a few different ones. So I don't know what the top ranking one right now is, but in terms of like our own ability to, share, that's something that we've been talking about a lot, is the quality of our interactions is really important. And I think as we're working from home, it's really tempting to treat each video meeting as just like, I don't know, a meeting, you know, and there's no, you know, I think it's really important to just set aside a little time for just being humans, you know, the moments that the water cooler moments when you're not in the meeting room, it's between meetings, you know, whatnot. You can't overestimate the importance of just connecting as humans every single day, multiple times a day, while we're in this for the long haul. Like, it'll become very old very quickly if we don't intentionally make time for that.
Yeah, I think the repurposing of tools is exciting too. It's like when there's a drastic change or somebody comes up with an idea to use something in a way that wasn't intended, is always kind of fun. And we're seeing some of that with simple internal tools, just things, tools to ask questions and upvote those questions for group discussions or all hands. So we're starting to see those of people sharing, like there might be the food list and people are upvoting recipes and stuff. So it's like the little things like that create the fabric of the community. And just by repurposing tools, not even changing their functionality, just making use of them in different ways.
That's great. I'm hoping we can conclude our conversation with what I'm sure is on a lot of folks' minds, and that is, well, how do I get started with something like this at an org if mine isn't as large or have 20% projects? Mike, in particular, you had talked about the pain and passion duality as something to look for in your coworkers, teammates, and folks. Don't you just love this, like, that face of like, damn it, Ben, another one of these. Said that, but like, Mike, on the call last week, do you remember when you said, you know?
Yeah, you're all my flippant phraseology is coming back to me.
I thought it was a useful way to, you know, if somebody's out there like, okay, but these are Google folks and they have, you know, lots of time, you know, bumping into people left and right, like, what if you're in a smaller org and you want to start thinking about and working on culture? What might they do?
Yeah, I think the idea stemmed from, so Nicholas Chekhov, who used to be at Google, he like tagged me a free radical once, and I looked that up, and the scientific definition wasn't super flattering, but the founder of 99U had written a nice manifesto, which resonated. And at some point, all through my sort of change agent instigation stuff, people would say, you need to figure out how to scale yourself. I still hear it today. Everybody says it all the time. And I started to think about, like, what is the thing that I do that instigates change that I might be able to communicate to others? And so that's where the pain and passion model came from. And then there's many examples, but the concept is, like, if you find somebody that has the pain, like this shared need, then they have motivation. And if you find people that are motivated, so they have this pain, but they're also passionate about it, meaning that they have ideas and they have an enthusiasm of how to fix it, you got to look for those two things. And it seems obvious, but there's a lot of folks who are just like, yeah, this sucks, it bothers me, but like somebody else will fix it, or I hope somebody else does. But eventually, once in a while, you find people that have both that pain and that passion. When you do, you just give them a lot of encouragement. You're like, okay, let's do it. Let's, like, I like that idea. And clearly this is something we can fix. And so you drag them through it. And I don't know how long it'll take and how, you know, how deep it'll get, but it's like, once you find that, you kind of got to hook it and pull it along. At least that was the case when I was, again, doing this individually. I think, Margaret, you might have a more eloquent way of thinking about how that translates into the way we look at our communities today.
Yeah. I think even at a small scale, some of the challenges that we constantly are trying to make better are the same. You know what I mean? It's that like free flow of information, I think, can be a problem in a really, you know, in the smallest of organizations. Like I said, I think maybe it's human nature to want to kind of like own things, but you know, when you're at a company, everyone owns everything, really, right? So like, if you can take that approach, who has the common, I mean, maybe it is that is the pain and passion model. Like, who, you know, where's the overlap for what you're doing that somehow isn't getting done, and who has the other side of that overlap, and just figuring out like that connection, and you know, can you solve it together? Because it's really hard to do this on your own, right? Because community takes more than one person, so you have to find like who in your community is going to care about the same things.
I feel like our team is overflowing with the passion for this stuff, and what we've gotten good at is, you know, sourcing and prioritizing the pain. Or that's where we really try to, like, that's the leadership council. Like, we source and go to them and with what recommended prioritization of the pain, and they sort of help us reshape that a little bit. But then it comes back on the passion of us and the community to deliver on that. And so we're trying to channel that passion to address those pains.
And again, communities are out there. They exist, and you know, it's identifying them, right? And like recognizing that there are people that are naturally connected somehow, and then figuring out how do you scale that by connecting two communities together.
And is that how you think organizations will be shifting and changing as they approach the new normal of work? I'm asking you to predict the future of how companies might or ought to think about distributed workforces, if like D-Scout, we were all based in Chicago, and now we're all in Chicago. And so we, of course, are thinking about how we can continue to ground one another in the ethos and the spirit of what we're doing. I'm wondering if you have any advice for a leader out there who is facing a team that is now distributed that wasn't before, or things that they could be thinking about as they're wondering to bring folks back, or, I mean, not health aside, but just like the spirit of cultivating.
Sure. Yeah. You know, I'll go back to recognize that we're humans first and we need humanity, you know, like we need that connection, you know, and if every connection that we have as we're working from home is cold and informal and structured, it's going to be really hard, right? Like I really believe that we have to just be so much more intentional about creating really quality connections, because it's just harder right now. I mean, there's just no two ways about it. Like we just don't have that, the advantage of serendipitous, you know, interactions. So we have to think about this differently, you know?
Yeah. I would say, like, if talking to a leader, say to look for and recognize the people who naturally have that need to connect folks and ideas, because you can only see so much. And if you find those people and you listen to them and sort of encourage them, then it just broadens your view of the world around you. So like you can then, you know, start to recognize the opportunities and the needs and find the ways to address them. But if you don't support those people in doing what they're naturally doing to surface that opportunity, then it's hard to see it, and especially harder today, because a lot of that, like Margaret is saying, a lot of that exchange is just less structured and formalized. It's not agenda driven. It's just something that sort of happens organically in an organization. So we're forced to disconnect right now. So we got to encourage it proactively.
And it's especially acute now because, you know, we're under incredibly stressful conditions, but you know, what we invest in now, understanding how people like to connect and how they possibly can connect again, it's not going to be something that's only good for this period of time. It'll have lasting benefit. Like we'll still use those techniques or whatever, and you know, recognize the needs of each other. And you know, I mean, I don't know if there is a bright side to what we're going through in 2020, but I do think that it's helped us largely recognize, like, I don't know, just let our guard down a little bit. And I hope that, you know, because we're all here in our homes every single day with our families and pets and whatnot. And, you know, people with different levels of ability to be productive. And I hope we have like a lot of empathy for one another and that it's not a temporary condition, you know, because that's what's going to make a really strong culture and a more bonded community.
Yeah, it has been really instructive for me when the trend to offices trying to feel more like home, I think, is a way to help us empathize with one another in these private spaces. Yeah. But they can be clinical and sterile. I mean, they need to be clean now more than ever. I love seeing my colleagues in their homes because it you know, they're not putting on any airs. They woke up and they're working on problems with me on things. And so it is very much, for me, an empathizing moment to have the visual cue of like, oh, right, you just ate because I see something on your face, but I'm glad you're here at the meeting. So, well, Mike, Margaret, it was so wonderful to spend a little bit of your time with you. Thank you so very much. Thanks again, Mike and Margaret. It was wonderful to see you.
Thanks for having us.
Of course. Thank you, people.
Thanks, everybody, for tuning in.
Of course.